thank you for joining us on this Sunday morning. Certainly in the name of Jesus, the Christ of the living God that does all things so very well. We can't thank him enough for everything he's done, what he's doing now, what it is that he is about to do. I want to welcome you to a little segment that the Lord blessed me with called Every Closed Eye Ain't Sleep, Every Goodbye Ain't Gone. And it'll be a series of sermons that we bring to you live and through via YouTube in order to present to you a message from God on Sunday mornings because of the coronavirus. We know that God has pressed the reset button so that where all of us had difficulty being in unity with one another, now, because of social separation and social distancing, now we'll appreciate one another when we get together again because we are apart. Our prayers are for all of the families who've been touched by this, for it's been millions, 3.3 million unemployed. There's been hundreds of thousands of infectious disease that have ravaged people, as well as thousands of deaths all throughout the world. Our special prayers go out to our healthcare workers who are on the front line. And I just want to stick a pin here that in bringing these messages forward, that we appreciate certainly your donations in order to keep us going on the air. It's not free, but we gladly give to you. Whatever money that you donate to us, we will gladly give it back in some kind of relief form for socially disadvantaged in our community. There's a lot of women and children, as well as our brothers who have been touched by this coronavirus, and they're not able to work right now. One of our plans is to give back in the way of foodstuffs through Helen's Kitchen, 708 15th Street North in Columbus, Mississippi, as well as other relief efforts with our healthcare workers. I want to turn your attention to the book of Hebrews, the third chapter, verses 8 through 9 and 12 through 14, where the Word of God says, "Do not harden your hearts as in the rebellion on the day of testing in the wilderness, where your fathers put me to the test and saw my words for 40 years. Take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God. But exhort one another every day as long as it is called today, that none of you may be hardened by the deceitfulness of sin. For we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end." And we just want to take these passages of Scripture, and we want to tag the text where it says in verse 9, "Where your fathers put me to the test and saw my works for 40 years, take care, brothers, lest there be in any of you an evil, unbelieving heart leading you to fall away from the living God." And we want to tag it with verse 14, "For we have come to share in Christ, if indeed we hold our original confidence firm to the end." And we just want to just talk from the thought, and this is the title of our message on this morning, "Don't forget how good God has been to you." Don't forget how good God has been to you. Certainly giving reverence to Jesus, the Christ, the living God who does all things so very well. I want to open up with a question. What kind of impact do you think it would have on your life if you personally witnessed a stream of non-stop miracles in your life? That's what happened to the children of Israel, as Paul, the Apostle Paul, is speaking of in the book of Hebrews. The children of Israel, when they left Israel, they wandered in the wilderness for 40 years. This is what Hebrews is telling us this morning in verses 3 and 9 of Hebrews. It says, "Your fathers tempted me and proved me, saw my works for 40 years. They tempted God. They put God to the test. individually and collectively, we know that God has been good to us. They had the nerve, the audacity, to see if God's quality is as good as others have claimed. And you know, we test God like that. We want to see if God is really God. And we can just look around in the world today and we can see that God is truly God. He's showing the rich as well as the poor that He is God, the small as well as the great that He is God, the male as well as the female, the old as well as the young, that He is still God. And He is good. And He is good not only as others have claimed, but see, God doesn't need any help. Now, human nature, the flesh, will test God to see if He really meets our expectation. And sometimes that old flesh will get into us and will rise up, and we want to see if God meets our expectations. And even though we're in a situation that demands miraculous intervention, we still doubt God. Right now, our current situation, trouble, bad circumstances, it might be a time to allow God to show in your life who He really is. God told the Israelites in this scripture that He is good, but still they tested Him. And God took the opportunity to show He's everything that He declares Himself to be. Now, you can apply the same principles in your life. You had heard and believed that God is a supernatural provider. Your situation has created a moment for God's goodness, grace, and delivering power. The wonderful side of this is the equivalent of us saying, Lord, You say You are my provider. Show me who You are. Please provide in my situation. When we prove God, we will find Him to be faithful, true, immovable, and steadfast. Hebrews 3:9, it says that they saw God's works for 40 years and never once did God fail them. They expressed this high level of power on a continual basis. How did they do that? I'm glad you asked me. Number one, they received manna for 40 years. They had quail to come supernaturally in the wilderness. From a rock flowed enough water to nourish them all. And let's just take a look at these statements for a moment. Many scholars number the nation of Israel at around 3 million people. That's an astronomical number of people. That means that they needed 4,500 tons of manna every day. God fed His people every day for 40 years. This means that 65,700,000 tons of manna supernaturally appeared on the ground for 40 years. It appeared so regularly, day in and day out, that after a while, the children of Israel didn't think too much of it anymore. And you know what? Sometimes God blesses us so abundantly, so graciously, so wonderfully, until we really don't pay the blessing any attention anymore. Did you know it's just a blessing to be alive? Did you know it's just a blessing to have your health and strength? Now I want to ask you a question. What if 4,500 tons of fresh bread fell tomorrow morning free at your doorstep? You know what? Scientists would come. Yes, CNN would come. A worldwide sensation would hit the airwaves. Just think of after it. After a while, Israel didn't even want the manna anymore. What about the quail? That's the little birds that be in the wilderness that they eat sort of like a chicken. Well, what about the quail? Well, God sent quail to feed His people Israel. Listen, of each Israelite, if each Israelite ate one quail a day, in 1 month, 90 million quail would be required. God is supernatural. He's a supernatural provider. And what about the water that came out of the rock? God's people were in a wilderness, a barren, dry place. No natural source of water to nourish 3 million people. It would have taken 15 million gallons of water every day just to meet the basic needs of Israel's requirements. 100 million gallons of water for just 1 week's supply. God told Moses to strike a rock. When Moses obeyed, water supernaturally flowed from the midst of a rock. And despite all that the Israelites had heard, seen, and experienced from God, They became hard-hearted, stiff-necked, hard-headed, rebellious. And if we evaluate our own life, we may find ourselves in this very same condition. He changed you. He healed you. He delivered you. He freed you. He rescued you. He gave you a new job. He put money in your pocket. Non-stop miraculous provisions in all our lives. But yet we are still tempted to worry, to doubt, to be insensitive, and to be unthankful and ungrateful. Don't you think it would be good for us to stop what we're doing and recount the blessings of God and express eternal gratefulness to Him today? As we continue to remind ourselves of God's goodness and maintain a thankful heart, we will avoid falling into that same old trap of the hard-hearted and stiff-necked Israelites, those children of Israel. And as I get ready to close this message, you and I know that all across Mississippi and all across the country, there are many vacant churches. There are many churches that don't have a pastor and have no leadership. There are many congregations who even are saying now that they don't even want a pastor. But I'm reminded of a letter that was submitted in a story a long time ago. And this letter said, "Dear church member, in our search for a suitable pastor, the following scratch sheet was developed for the church's personal review. And of the candidates investigated by our Right Religious Committee, only one was found to have the necessary qualities. This is a list containing the names of each candidate and comments on each. And if you're interested in investigating them for future pastoral placements, oh, here was, of 120 years, only 8 members, not one convert, prone to unrealistic building projects and a drinking problem. Then there was another candidate by the name of Reverend Joseph, a big thinker, a bragger, a dreamer, and he had a prison record. Then there was Reverend Moses, a modest and meek man, poor communicator, even stuttered sometimes, had an explosive temper, left an earlier church over a murder charge. Then there was Reverend Abraham, who took off to Egypt, and during hard times he got into trouble and authorities tried to see his way out of it, but he lied about who he was with. Then there was Reverend David, the most promising leader of all, until our committee discovered that he had an affair with his neighbor's wife. There was Reverend Solomon, where he was very scholastic, he was very ingenious, he was a great builder, but he failed to practice what he preached. There was a Reverend Elijah, who proved to be inconsistent and known to fold under pressure. What about Reverend Hosea, who made our scratch sheet? He was a tender, loving pastor, and he put our church in conflict because we couldn't handle the First Lady's occupation. His family life was in shambles, and Reverend Hosea divorced and remarried a prostitute. What about Reverend Jonah? Jonah refused God's call into ministry, but forced to obey by getting swallowed by a great fish. He told us the fish spit him out on the shore near here, and in our shock we hung up the phone. Reverend Jeremiah, a good preacher, but he was too emotional, crying all the time, and many say he's a pain in the neck. And Reverend Amos, he comes from the country farming, and he has a farming background, but he's better off picking fruit. Reverend John says he's a Baptist, but definitely doesn't dress like one. He wouldn't feel comfortable at the church third Sunday supper because our sisters on the kitchen committee don't know how to cook wild locusts and honey. Reverend Peter has a bad temper, been known to cuss you out, had a big run-in with Paul in Antioch, and too aggressive and a loose cannon. And Reverend Paul, of course, we forced him to lack attacked and he was too harsh and his appearance was contemptible and he preached for an awful long time. Then there was Reverend Timothy. He had all the potential, but the Reverend is much too young for the position. Reverend Jesus, who offends church members with all of his teaching and preaching, especially all of his Bible scholars, and he's also controversial, had popular appeal in church, and he had a church to grow to 4,000, then it grew to 5,000, and he managed to offend them all, and his membership then dwindled down to only 12 people. He offended even the church committee with all of his pointed questions. He seldom stayed in one place too long, and of course, he's single. But then there's Reverend Judas, and he's very practical, very cooperative, and he's also good with money. Cares for the poor, he dresses well. We have all agreed that he is just the man we're looking for to fill the vacancy of our senior pastorship. Thank you all for your consideration, all of what you have done in our Christian pastoral search. Sincerely, the Pastoral Search Committee for the Christian Faith Church, Deacon Do Right, Sister Sanctified, and Secretary Sanctimonious. And as I close, I want to ask you, do you know who Jesus is? He arrived at Golgotha Calvary. He was rejected, and the soldiers, they offered him wine mixed with gall. They divided up his clothes, and they shot craps for him. They put a sign over my Lord's head. This is Jesus. He's the King of the Jews. They hung him and crucified him between two thieves. And I heard Jesus say, Father, forgive them, for they don't know what they're doing. And everyone passing by, they scorned my Lord, but he fed the 4,000, the 5,000. He healed many lepers and was healed the lame, made the lame walk, and the blind, he made them see. Do you know him? They took him and they marched him down a road called Calvary. They made him carry a 200-pound cross. And he carried that cross, and then they nailed him to that cross. And I tell you, it was love, for he loves us more than we love ourselves. It was love that nailed him to the cross. It was love as they nailed him to the cross. They stretched him wide and they lifted him up, fulfilling that word that if I be lifted up, I will draw all men unto me. And Jesus, they hung him up and the blood came streaming down. He died from the sixth to the ninth hour. He died until the temple was split in two. He died as that blood came streaming down. He died and the earth shook like a drunken man. He died and the stars fell out their sockets. He died, but that wasn't the rest of the story. They took him down, they wrapped him up, and they put him in a borrowed tomb. But you know what? Oh, death, where is your victory? And sin, where is your sting? Because he got up. Yes, he got up. Because he lives. How do I know he lives? Because he lives in you and me. My brothers and sisters, I thank you for listening to this message on this morning. I ask that you would support our ministry simply by sending your donations to Kamal Karriem Jr., 1516 15th Avenue North, Columbus, Mississippi, 39701. Also, if you need prayer, you can give us a call at area code 662-435-3732. Remember, in our closing, every closed eye ain't sleep, every goodbye ain't gone, and Jesus Christ, he is Lord.